No, 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 don't rush. You have your time.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Karl, for having me here today. I'm a PhD student also in Ilmenau, as is Philip, and I'm with Thomas Hott, who's also in Ilmenau. And the work I present today is a joint work together with Pablo Burkhardt from Trier and also Till Krüger from Wrocław, whom you've already heard today. And this work is also supported by the German Federal Ministry of Education and Research, the BMBF, and I'm very grateful for that support. Yeah, so I want to talk about real-time monitoring of the epidemic, of the SARS-CoV-2 epidemic, but of course the techniques I'm going to present could also be applied to any other epidemic in the future. This real-time monitoring has become a pretty widespread also in the media during the last day. I think it's not last year, not a single day goes by where in the news you don't have the current amount of infectious, of reported cases, of deaths, of ICU capacities that are taken. And so this is, of course, an important topic, not only for the public, but also for the government officials who are making public health decisions. And so this monitoring is, of course, very essential. And up until now, we've heard a lot of talks, I think, especially yesterday, and also the talk from Philip before, where we had a deterministic setting, and we considered ODEs. And I want to deviate a little bit from that and maybe go more into the direction that Krüger presented earlier today and go to a stochastic setting and also to a discrete time setting. And in this setting, you can model the spread of an epidemic in a pretty standard way, but following reproduction equation. So we have at time t, amount of I of t new incident cases. And if you condition them on the past incidences, which we do here, standard assumption is to model this by Poisson distribution with intensity given by a product of both the instantaneous reproduction number R of t and a convolution of the past cases with, which I denote here by W, the generation time. So you can think of this term here, this convolution of the past incidences with the generation time as the currently infectious people. And the generation time you might also think of as, given that you are a primary case and you infect the secondary case, what's the probability that you infect that case on day tau after you you yourself became infected? So as I said, I'm interested now in monitoring the spread of the of such an epidemic, and then straightforward, the goal is now to estimate the reproduction number R. And as a very established estimator, it's also well studied, which I denote throughout this talk by R hat. And for this, you just take the amount of new incident cases on day T, I of T, and divide it by the sum of the past incidences convoluted with the generation time. Of course, this assumes somehow that you know the generation time, but we'll assume that we know it for this talk. And this estimate is well studied and has some nice properties. And it works good for a large amount of cases. So when I and also the denominator here are large, this works well. And I'm interested in scenarios where this estimate doesn't perform as good as one might expect. And for that, I've brought some data from Germany, from the SARS-CoV-2 epidemic last year. So here we have some the amount of newly reported infections by the Robert Koch Institute in the last year, between May and July. And first of all, you can see that there's a strong weekly pattern in the data, which is also something we're going to ignore for now for this talk. But despite this weekly pattern, we can see that we have here 2 weeks where maybe the amount of new infections is somewhat constant. And then you have a 1 week where we have a rise in infections. And then the two following weeks, we have, again, we're back at this baseline level maybe of the first 3 weeks. So what actually happened here is that there was a large outbreak, which also went kind of viral in the media. This was an outbreak in a meat processing plant in Tönnies meat processing factory. And yeah, so we have this local outbreak here, which we can already see dominate somehow the infections in the whole of the country. And what does that do to the reproduction numbers that we estimate? Well, that's what I depicted here. So first of all, we do some slight correction of the dates here because we're somehow interested in for the reproduction numbers, we're interested in the dates when people became infectious, and the official data, of course, are only when the cases were reported to the Robert Koch Institute. So we backdate by 1 week. That's why the peak here in the reproduction numbers is 1 week earlier than in the plot on the left-hand side. But we see two things here. First of all, the reproduction numbers that are associated with the with this local outbreak, they are of course larger than the ones in the weeks before, but also the reproduction numbers in the two following weeks are a bit lower than one would maybe expect. So if you think about this outbreak as an event that occurs maybe only in 1 week, you would expect maybe the reproduction number to be constant before, constant after, and maybe we would want to see this peak during the outbreak. And that this doesn't happen is due to the form of this estimator. We divide here by the amount of past cases. And so if we have this outbreak where we have a lot of cases in the past week, then they will influence our estimates in the weeks to come. And that's from a public, so if you're deciding on policies, maybe undesirable, because if you're in this week, you might think, oh, okay, we've got a large reproduction number, maybe we have to implement a lot of measures now to get the cases down. But in the following 2 weeks, you might think, oh, our reproduction numbers are quite low, maybe we can relax a little bit. And in both scenarios, that might not be the whole picture. In the first week, you only had a local outbreak where you don't have to implement measures in the whole country. And in the other 2 weeks, you had still reproduction numbers, maybe above one, and it maybe not the right time to lift the measures here. Okay, so, and to deal with this problem, we would like to have reproduction numbers, not on the whole country level, but on a more local level, on the county level. And that also makes sense because a lot of aspects of the epidemic are different among different counties. So there's a lot of heterogeneity there. So for example, different countries have a different amount of active cases, so prevalence is different. The countermeasures vary by county. And of course, there's also socioeconomic factors. There's a difference in the spread maybe between city and more rural areas. And that's why I would like to model reproduction numbers on a county level. And we'd hope that this also gets rid of the problem from the last slide. But going to the county level introduces another set of problems because now the data are of course fewer, right? We have in Germany, we have 401 counties. And that means that of course, for every one county, you have a lot less data, especially in the scenario from the last summer where you have just overall low incidences. Also on a county level, the data are much more variable, and you have effects where you exchange cases between counties. So if you go shopping to the big city, you get infected there and you come back to your home, then you're reported as a case in your hometown, but of course you got infected somewhere else. So these are all effects that you will have to consider. And so now I'm going to step by step add those to the model. We start again with this reproduction equation, where we have now incidences on the county level denoted with this index of C. And again, we condition on the past incidences and we model them as Poisson distributed. And for brevity, I've introduced this phi c, which is just the convolution of the generation time, so the currently infectious cases in that county. So if we were now to, just for every county, estimate the reproduction number individually, then we would have to estimate over 400 parameters. And that's somehow a very high dimensional problem, and we don't really want to deal with that. Instead, what we're going to do is we're going to use a technique from a small area estimation, and we're going to assume that the reproduction numbers are random and come from a common distribution. So the reproduction numbers on the country level are now somehow coupled in this common distribution. And if we reduce the amount of parameters to the parameters of this distribution, the dimension of the problem becomes much lower. Because the reproduction numbers are now random, we always also have to condition onto them. And I did just that above here. And the next step, we do some another extension where we also allow for imported and exported cases between counties. So now we also add a parameter PT for exchanging infections across counties. And then of course, we will have to, for one county C, we'll also have to consider all other counties C prime here, and thus we also condition on them implicitly in our model here. Okay. So now all that's left for the estimation is to specify the distribution for the reproduction numbers. And for mathematical convenience, maybe we're going to use a gamma distribution for those reproduction numbers. And that's because the gamma distribution fits nicely to the Poisson distribution. It is a conjugate prior to the Poisson distribution that leads to some nice computations later on. So due to that, we can just integrate out the reproduction numbers, and we obtain a negative binomial distribution whose parameter we know we can compute from first all the available data, so the incidences and the assumed parameters. And if we now assume those to have those to be conditionally on the past incidences be independent, we can use maximum likelihood estimation and estimate those parameters A, S, and P. Okay, so now we have the parameters for our model, and we have to now use them to also estimate reproduction numbers. And that's pretty straightforward now, again, because we have this, we've chosen this gamma distribution for reproduction numbers that fits nicely with the Poisson assumption for the cases. And we know that the reproduction number is conditional on the incidences, not that I now have also the today's incidences here in the conditioning is again gamma distributed. And we can calculate these parameters again from known data and the estimated parameters by just plugging in the maximum likelihood estimates. And so now we have the whole distribution of this RC after plugin available, but we're just going to focus on maybe the conditional expectation of the reproduction number in one county given the past incidences. And that you can do by plugin. And similarly by plugin, we can also get an estimator for the reproduction number on the country level, which is so to say the grand mean of all county level reproduction numbers, again by plugin. So just a small simulation study that this estimator really produces meaningful results. I'm going to simulate a point process on a flat torus where I've chosen here a 20 set to get 400 unit squares in my flat torus. So we can approximate the 401 counties in Germany. So every unit square in this flat torus, we will think of as one county. You know? So you have one square is one county. And then the simulation is pretty straightforward. We start with some cases distributed in the torus. And for every case, we will just keep track of their infection age, so time since they were infected. And they will generate according to the generation time distribution. And in the simulation specified reproduction number will generate new cases, new secondary cases here in orange. And the position of those cases will just draw again randomly caution and centered around the primary cases. And maybe here in the first step, this case infects one case, then maybe we get two, another one, and so on. And of course, those cases become infectious also, and they infect other cases as well. And so all that's left is to specify what's the reproduction number and the generation time does. So here is just assumed generation time increasing for some days, constant, and then decreasing again. And then I'm going to consider two scenarios. One where we have a constant reproduction number for all counties, which is first of all large, then there's some restrictions, then we go down below one, and then we go back up a little bit above one. And a second scenario where we're more interested in the county reproduction number. So we do the same thing and simulate a small outbreak in a 3x3 square of counties and interested in whether we can identify those counties with our new estimates. Okay, first of all, on the county level reproduction number, we can estimate pretty nicely. Also, because we're doing maximum likelihood estimation, we get confidence intervals, which I've also depicted here, and repeating the simulation in the Monte Carlo simulation, we also get that the coverage of the confidence intervals is quite close to the 95% we assumed here. Okay, so that works quite nicely. Also for the counties, we again have the same simulation, just that we have now some counties where we increase the reproduction number, and those are the ones that I have here plotted in green. And this outbreak happens in this gray marked area, and we can identify those counties there. We can distinguish them at least visually quite nicely from the reproduction numbers estimated in the other counties. Okay, simulations are nice, but it would be much nicer to also apply this to real data, and that's what I've done here. Again, this is the plot from the first slide that I showed you, where we had this outbreak in the meat processing plant. In green, I have this new estimator on the country level based on county data. And we can see that in the week of the outbreak, we still have slightly elevated estimates. But in the following weeks, we don't have this underestimation of the reproduction number for the old results, which were the dashed orange lines here. So that looks quite nicely. And also what we can now do is apply this estimator also on the county level. Where again, we could also do this before, but this might have some problems because of this sparse data. Maybe we have some, we estimate some zero reproduction numbers here in the for the orange plot, which is the old approach, and the new approach is maybe a little bit more stable. Here I've plotted, because we're virtually in Wuppertal, I plotted the reproduction number in the same period of time for the Wuppertal county. And yeah, so that also works quite well, I'd say. And also if case numbers are big enough, then those two estimators coincide more or less. Well, that means that we've come to the end of my talk. Just to quickly recap. So this estimator we've introduced here uses more area estimations to techniques to couple reproduction numbers between different counties together. And in simulations where we have also introduced model mismatch, this behaved quite nicely. On the country level, it improves on this problem where we have outbreaks which dominate the countrywide infection. And on the county level, it gives sensible estimates, I'd say, despite located case counts. And of course, you could extend this now. And that's actually what we're currently working on is, first of all, this assumption that the reproduction numbers are gamma distributed, of course, only for mathematical convenience, because you can easily integrate out the reproduction numbers. You don't have to do Markov-Chain Monte Carlo simulations for that. But ideally, these outbreaks are, of course, events that happen somehow in the tail, and the gamma distribution is maybe not suited for that. So that's, of course, one point where we would like to have more heavy tail distributions for the reproduction numbers. And then what would also be interesting is if we could identify effects of socioeconomic factors. For example, can we compare cities to more rural counties? So are there more bigger reproduction numbers in cities than in rural countries? And as we've seen, the data, of course, have those weekday effects, which we'd like to get rid of. And also the backdating by 1 week is kind of crude at the moment. This is also something we would like to take care of. Okay, now I think I've switched my time a little bit. Thank you for your attention, and I'm ready to take questions.